Okay, the recording right now.
It doesn't say on air, it says recording.
How we doing? Y'all set?
Let's begin tonight's meeting. Okay, did everybody get a chance to look at the draft minutes from the last meeting?
No, but I want to hear.
Okay. Pete, did you look at them?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I'm sorry.
No.
Okay.
Well, you know what, it's funny, I got a couple of tick bites recently, and I was able to go, you know, with this and say, this is the tick that got bitten by.
Typically, deer tick.
Yeah, it was. Okay, I move that we accept the draft minutes of October 4th as amended.
As drafted.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so what's first on your?
Well, we do have mowing. Should we do this with bills payable?
Okay.
And so Joe Radwich did the orchard, and I don't know if anyone's been up there, but this is a picture. He mowed the meadow.
All right, I'll turn it in, I'll get it.
That's the meadow at the orchard.
Oh, wow.
I know, and so it's actually, this was like walking in, but people have been taking pictures saying, the orchard looks beautiful. Well, and we waited, you know, quite late the season to make sure the butterflies and all the insects had hit it. It was cold, so it's the same price he's been charging for 2 years.
Okay, I move that we pay this bill for mowing at the Field Street Orchard.
And that comes out of the whip account.
All in favor?
Aye.
Beautiful. I didn't get that far today.
What kind of time is it now, is it?
Five-ish.
Okay, so we could probably do, actually, this was a young man named Shane Yost. He did a life, he did some work at the, on the Red Trail on Pepperell Springs. He used all hand tools to do some clearing and things like that. There were trees that were leaning over the trail, and he took them down. There were some trees that went down, so people were forming new trails around them. And so I suggested, like in my comments, that maybe we sent him a letter to thank him for, it was a Boy Scout, Life Scout project. So I just wanted to know if people wanted to, you know, just to show appreciation for the work. I mean, he was out there for like 7.5 hours or 8.5 hours, doing all this work by hand.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good idea. What's a Life Scout?
You know what? Do you know what a Life Scout is? I don't honestly know. I just know that.
Step up for Boy Scout.
Yeah. Yes. I should definitely ask. I should know that. Because the scouts, the Eagle Scouts, have done so much work for us. So we did the mowing at the Hill Street Orchard. Then the town meeting went through for the to protect the land behind the senior center, so there's all kinds of things going on there to finish it up and get about 70 acres, or 65 acres protected. We do have a request for certificate of compliance for Pepperell Family Pharmacy. And so Jack Tuski provided as-built plans, and he showed, because remember what we did was they came back and wanted to, it was porous pavement, change the pavement, put some drainage and make sure everything sloped towards either the catch basins or towards the, there was a drainage area with check dams, and DEP had come out and held it, it would be okay.
Mm-hmm.
So at this point, they're requesting a certificate of compliance for that project.
I move that we issue a certificate of compliance for 74 Main Street, 259-715.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
He's not going to address it here. He's got to just check in the box.
And we haven't heard anything about the appeal for Prescott Street yet. Still waiting to hear on that.
Okay. Oh, from DEP?
Yeah, from DEP. They said about 3 weeks, and it's pretty close to it. But I know that they're pretty backed up.
Mr. Karen, what? Yeah, it's almost 7:10.
Oh,
you can do what you got to
do.
No,
you're next. That's one you have a seat. So you're looking for request for extension, I know we, and you, I'm told that you had the wetlands flagged.
Yep.
Okay, so,
And I guess it hasn't changed, so she said she was gonna go by the existing map, so.
Yes.
And that's for, explicitly for lot one?
Yes.
Yep.
Not the.
Yeah, we're gonna cross the next bridge when we come to it, as far as the, parcel one and that.
Okay. So what were you thinking, how many years has this been extended already, about?
We started.
It got extended, and then,
Extension Act.
There was a two-year, then a three-year.
Right.
Then another three.
Then we went into the big depression.
Three, then there was, then there was the Extension Act, another four, so it's already been 11 years, right?
Right, not too bad.
Okay.
Well, the, I was reading the act for another reason, and, it was pointed out for the act itself, in the discussion of it, that there are three extensions are allowed. This was, for order of conditions. So, it seems to me, this one's all right, because it's all confused with the governor's extension anyway, we can't do another one.
Yes.
Right.
Well, you know, too, is Ellen thought that we automatically had to get three at the beginning, but she didn't understand. And she talked to the DEP, it was kind of new, and they didn't understand, so it got extended to three, then to the three fell within the four-year period, got extended another. So you got an extra 3 years already. Okay, but we gotta reflect, so what do you wanna do this for, another 2 years or 3 years, what do you think?
I know, it's up to you, 'cause this would be the last extension, but you have some interest, you said possibly, in the lot?
Yeah, I've got, yeah, actually, yeah, I've got somebody interested in the lot, but I mean, I'd rather get it as long as I can, just in case, you know what I mean?
It's no more than 3 years allowed, and the wetland's pretty close to the way it was before, this, actually, silt fence is down, but it is still even silt fence there to show the area not to be disturbed. It's right off Elm Street, can you see it?
How far off, downhill?
It's not as far down as Shirley, so that left, keep going up north, see where that pond is, it's almost right across from there. Yeah, it's, Heron Crossing, it goes back into the woods, it's.
Yeah, I see it's a parcel that looks like it goes around a bunch of parcels.
Yes.
It's an interesting, because it was part of a four-house subdivision.
Maybe this will be easier to see it, too. This is the right one? I can't look.
Right here.
That's it, yeah.
It is, that parcel.
Oh, wow. Even this, here's Elm.
Right, this is the common drive coming up, and it's right at the end of the common drive.
And it's lot one, just lot one. So see how, because of the wet area here?
There's another plan, Chris.
Everything's pretty much over, the house would have to be here, the septic would have to be there. Yeah.
It's town sewer in there, if it makes any difference.
And we have re-flagged the wetlands.
So the flags, we want to be sure they were visible, and they're definitely visible there.
So it's the, what we're approving, the extension on, is this, is the wetland edges on what is shown as lot one.
Right.
And not the parcel B, and not the other side.
Right, but see, Jack Wisniewski told me that after a certain number of years, obviously that would have to be flagged or whatever, I think it was flagged at one point.
It got re-flagged.
In order to make.
Oh, he means this, parcel B.
Was flagged at one point because it was surveyed, so that you could see where the wetland was, but anyway. He told me that after a certain number of years, if I sell that.
74 Main Street?
If I sell the lot and the parcel, when somebody pulls a building permit, that line disappears.
From the perspective of the Conservation Commission, the wetlands have, we have not approved.
Right, we're just, you're approving to that line, I realize that.
And I, well, I'm trying to be explicit about it.
Right, right.
What's going on, and whatever else.
I'd have to file.
Would have to be filed, and all the zoning stuff, not our problem.
Right.
That's got to go.
Right, right, I have no problem with that, right.
Because what was approved was lot one, not parcel B, which is not part of this right now.
And I disagree that lot one. disappears.
That's what Jack told me.
Yeah, I think he's wrong, but... This is lot one, this is parcel B. Parcel B is not a building lot.
Right, because it has no frontage. But he said that that line would disappear and that would become one 10-acre lot rather than two, 5 acres and another 5 acres.
It has to be done. It doesn't do it automatically.
I know, I'm just going by what Jack told me.
No, I think he's wrong, but okay. We're just approving this extension on lot one. How long? 2 years, 3 years? What is comfortable with?
Well, the wells didn't change in the
11 years.
So we can be fairly sure that from the wetlands perspective and from what we're concerned about, that 3 years is probably all right. With the understanding that that's the end of the extensions.
Okay.
We approve an extension for 3 years.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Okay.
Now comes the bad part, I got paid, right?
Yeah, $100.
It's supposed to be before we even just started the discussion?
Yes.
Well, there wasn't a form, I guess, yeah, okay.
Oh, okay, do we sign anything?
Yes. Oh, wait, yeah. There it is.
All of those.
I knew he had it. We talked. This is the wet, and the bylaw?
Yeah, okay.
The extension?
Yes.
I know.
Amongst the things I was reading is that you don't have a discussion until everything's paid.
Yeah, usually it's like, if you need to get pennies, we make you go out and get pennies, right?
I got pennies on my truck, if you need them.
Okay, nice. Okay, thanks, Bob. I'll send you it.
Okay, Bob's that?
Yes.
Okay, very good. And then we'll fight it out over the back lot, thank you.
Yes.
Okay, very good.
Not with us.
All right, thank you.
Exactly. Except for the wet one line.
You know what was interesting is that Jack, when I spoke with Jack, Jack said that the lot shape factor, by including that lot in any of those lots back there, it made it so the, or it prevented it from meeting the lot shape factor. So they don't like to leave those lots just kind of in the air, but there was no way to include it and make meet the lot shape factor and the zoning.
I mean, you can sell two lots, doesn't mean it's access to it.
Yeah.
You can't build on it.
No. And it does say not a buildable lot, so.
Okay, so next we have a hearing 127. Chestnut Street?
Oh, yeah, 127 Chestnut.
You here for that?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. This is a request for determination. For 127 Chestnut Street, got a failed septic system. Okay, so is this, was a lot created before 202?
Yes.
Okay.
It was, my last change was 1997.
We'll just check to see if the local bylaw applies.
Okay, yep.
Yeah, so it's a wet one, and okay, so...
No riverfront.
So you paid your legal notice fee?
Yes.
So, yeah.
I received that.
Okay, and the $50, okay?
I'll pay.
Okay. Okay, and I have him sign in here too.
Where am I?
By the way, it's down, almost.
127.
Wait, it's a...
The other New Hampshire.
Is that West, Cranberry? What street is that called? Near we, not too far from you. What is...
Ashley going through there?
Beyond, it's way down. It's, I was saying,
on the map again?
Yes.
Oh.
Okay, you know where Lock Road is? Lock Road in Townsend?
Yes.
It's down at that end of Chestnut. It's really far down. Yes, they do. It's pretty, it's like almost, when I came out there, it's the part that, remember the town had like moved part of Chestnut Street? It's right in that general vicinity where they moved, it actually changed the line.
Okay.
Remember the highway department had moved Chestnut Street at one point? It's down just beyond that, right?
Okay.
Part of that.
All right. Brandon Ducharme Dillis. Here on behalf of our client, 127 Chestnut Street. And this is upgrade to an existing septic system. Sure, yeah.
Put it there, we'll find, that'd be good.
So it's an upgrade to an existing septic system. This is Chestnut Street out in the front here. This is the existing house. There's a driveway, existing gravel driveway. There is an existing well in the front, and this is the 100-foot well offset. And there is a bordering vegetated wetland out in the back. This, the pink delineates the limits of the lot. It's about a 4,400 square foot lot. The bordering vegetated wetland is here in the back. This is the corresponding 50-foot buffer zone, as well as the 100-foot buffer zone. And essentially what we're doing is, like I said, we're upgrading the existing septic system. And this is an existing four-bedroom home. They've got in-laws coming in, so they're adding a one-bedroom apartment. So the total design flow on this plan is for five bedrooms. Essentially, we're using concrete galleys. We're going to pick up, this is kind of the place of where the existing system was. We're going to pick up the sewer here and install a new septic tank. Because it's five bedrooms, we actually are greater than 440 gallons per day per acre for the design flow. So this site requires advanced treatment for nitrogen reduction. So we have two tanks here. This tank here basically is what houses the advanced treatment unit, which is a microfast system here. And then it goes to a dosing chamber, which basically pumps up and goes to the disposal system here. This green line kind of, there's a shed out in the back. This green line represents the existing wood line. This new system's gonna kind of be up in the woods here. This is our erosion control and kind of the limits of clearing that they'll need to clear up enough just to basically install the system. And obviously just be far enough away that we don't have any issues with root intrusion into the new septic. We're also showing a stockpile out here in the front, outside of the buffer zone. You know, the big reason that kind of pushes the septic system in the back is obviously in order to get the 100-foot offset to the well.
What's the dot on the front in the driveway?
This one here?
Yep.
Existing, it's a catch basin.
Okay.
Probably just a leaching catch basin. It's all sand and gravel.
What is the depth of the system?
The system, bottom is 96, elevation 96, and the grade up here is about 100. So it's about 4 feet. The bottom of the system is about 4 feet below grade. So the end, essentially we're not coming up in elevation, so it's basically we're restoring what the existing grade is.
And what are the soils in this area?
Sandy gravel. You know, it's two-minute perk rate. No groundwater, no modeling. Groundwater elevation is probably somewhere around what the wetland elevation is.
Which is?
Looks like around 92, 93.
Oh, yeah. So it's only 4 feet below.
4 feet below the bottom of the.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. 4 feet below the bottom of the this thing.
Yeah.
Might be a little higher. Yeah. Now, in your test, did you excavate down to the bottom of down to the elevation that'll be constructed?
Yeah. At? So I mean, they dug down 10 feet.
Okay.
No water.
No water.
Any other questions? Anybody in the audience have any questions, comments?
Is that an overburden well then? Also, their existing well?
It's existing drilled well, yeah.
Is it bedrock or root, yeah?
I'm not sure. I assume it's bedrock well.
I move that. No further discussions. I think we just, one of the typical conditions we have is that you would just notify Paula after the hay bales is staked, that she would go out and inspect.
And the Board of Health approval.
Oh, that's another issue.
Oh, they don't have, oh, this is the one?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can't approve?
What was the?
Well, we filed an RDA.
Right, so this is just a determination.
Right.
So what was the outstanding issues with the Board of Health at this point?
I don't believe it's gone to the Board of Health.
It's gone to them, she's reviewed it, but then you add one tank.
Yeah.
Okay, I think that was, yeah, the change was adding the, Jack did say, adding that treatment was basically the comment, given the fact that it exceeded the nitrogen loading for the lot.
And it occurs to me, when did the stamp of Brandon, what's the date on it?
November 1st.
Oh.
So I think.
Oh, I just.
Because we, yeah.
When's the last revision date then? 10, the first revision date?
10/21.
So 10/21 would have been, I think, when the Board of Health would have gotten a submittal for the, with the microfast treatment, it says, a few weeks, you know, 10 days ago. So their review's probably not complete yet, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, they're meeting tonight.
They are, yeah.
Yeah, but they're not discussing this.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering, but I didn't, you know.
No, but we, if are anything, you said it's an RDA, but if we do any decision, it has to be based on Board of Health not changing the plan.
Correct, yeah.
So, since we're all very formal these days, be very clear about that. It has to be provisional based on, no changes.
Yeah, we'd have to go back to you.
Or, do you wait till the?
Do we wait till the 16th when they review it? Well, it's up to you. I mean, or it's up to you, actually.
I mean.
I don't think it's gonna change.
Do you see?
I don't think, if they requested the microfast unit and they provided it, I don't think what the issue is. I mean, it's outside of the 100-foot buffer.
Yes.
Right, as long as it's, doesn't, as long as that's what it is, but sometimes things leap up out of the blue and we can't, we can approve as is, as proposed, but if it's, if there's changes, then it has to come back, that's all.
Yeah, anything beyond that, rev date?
Yes.
Anything beyond that, if you go further into the 100-foot, then you'd have to come back, right?
Correct, okay.
Okay, I have that.
Yeah, and we're comfortable with that, just given the fact that it's already gone to them and they issued a comment letter.
I move then that we issue negative determination number 3. While work is in the buffer zone, won't have an adverse impact on wetlands, therefore there's no need to file a notice of intent. And this is also number 6 allowed by a local bylaw.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you.
I know. I figured the way everything was coming down, I thought, oh, we've got to give some extra time.
Were you here for this?
What's that?
Should this gentleman also sign it because he was listening in on the conversation? Yeah.
Oh, is that for this here? Oh.
Yes. Oh, that's okay, but everybody who's in the room should sign it.
Yeah. It's a public hearing and you're part of the public.
Yes. Is anybody in the hall still?
No, they left.
They left.
That's just the service disposal.
You still have those pictures?
Yeah.
Okay. You still have those pictures?
Which one is it? No, it was right.
Oh, are they in?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
You sign that on the other piece.
Is that the picture I want to use to put in there?
No, here's the email. This is on the room.
About 8,000 dollars.
Oh. Yes. It wasn't, there was no time on the agenda.
Sorry, I think Jack gave us a revised copy.
Exactly, I appreciate it, thank you.
Yeah, I'm unaware of where the.
Bridge Drive is off of Plainfield Street. So if you're heading down Heald Street, and Plainfield's across from the cemetery on Heald Street, take that right, and as you go down there, very soon after you get down there, there's the road on the right, and it's only so far before you actually end up there. You know what I mean?
Isn't that little development?
Yes, yes. Okay. There's a road on the right, probably like four houses down.
Right.
It's a Boy Scout. And they're proposing a 40B. Currently, what it is like, you know how Plainfield or Plains, what it is you've got, we can't start the hearing, I'm sorry, till 7:40. But you've got, you know how you have like a road that goes down, and you roads in this, like, they're kind of fairly small lots that have been there since like 1965. Well, those lots were there, so they've been sitting there undeveloped since like 1965. And so the company that did Emerson Circle up by Hollis, New Hampshire, off of Nashua Road, the 40B there, they're proposing to do another 40B. And this there were like 21 lots. They were small, but it's similar to the lots that are there. So they're proposing to do 20 lots. It'll be a 40B, which is a comprehensive permit, which means they go through the Zoning Board of Appeals, and the only other, you know, there seems to be some wetland issues, which we will see more of. But as far as we know, the neighbors that were here said that it should actually be protected. They'd like to see it get protected. They came and spoke to the town administrator, and he suggested they find out, is there a willing seller? People that did all this work for this project, are they willing to sell the property? But like I said, that's between them if they decide they want to go forward. But this land does abut land owned by Neshoba Conservation Trust.
Yeah, we'd love to maybe drive there and check it out.
Okay. There are some plans mixed in through here, but it would be, the homes that you see up by Emerson Circle, they'd be similar to that.
But how many of those homes were truly 40B before they went for more market at Emerson?
At Emerson, there were 56 homes. How many? This is 20, out of the 20 homes, 5 would be affordable. So, but there's a lot.
There's basically two different approaches to see whether 20 or 25%.
It's a little over 6 acres.
And they have to be for 30 years.
Yeah.
Is it on the edge of that area?
It's next to Neshoba Conservation Trust property, but it's, that's kind of what they're proposing.
Yeah.
Before, it would have been just, the road would have been extended. It would have been 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 homes, or 21 homes. So now they're kind of proposing something like this, and there's obviously some wetlands here.
Yeah.
So there'll be more detail, but this is what they filed with the ZBA, and because they're out, just like at Emerson Circle, right? They had to, for the lots that were, they had wetland impacts, they'd have to come before the commission, and it's wooded.
It's also sand, isn't it? Sandy,
yeah.
Graveloid.
Yeah. That's what I recall in that area.
Exactly. So, and this is the selectmen have been supportive. They provided a letter in support for this project. So they consider it, at this point, like it's called a friendly 40B. There's opposition. But look, this is just to let everyone know here that, the ZBA will be having a hearing on December 6th and to discuss this. But then they would have to come before the commission with, before. A lot more details.
That wasn't one of the attachments to your email, was it?
No.
No, okay.
We were trying to figure out how this, when they scanned it, we asked for it electronically, and we didn't get an electronic version, but we definitely can, they're working on it.
I can just flip through it.
Yeah, if you want to look through it even now. But, like I said, there will be some wetland impacts, but.
But the town bylaw doesn't apply.
No, it doesn't, does it?
No, the zoning bylaw does not.
Yeah.
Any local bylaw.
Any local bylaw, but the Wetlands Protection Act applies, but our bylaw doesn't.
Right.
Exactly. They only go before the ZBA and then the commission, right? And they
because
did
because of the state act.
Exactly.
But only 5 of the lots are proposed as
affordable.
But it makes the whole project,
Project fall into that road.
So if I can, if it's the same people that did Emerson Village, they were reasonable to talk to. And I remember walking with them, they weren't pushing the edges of things. They were trying to do it right.
Yeah. Did you find that?
But it sounds like the people that did Emerson Village own the property now, but they're looking to sell the project?
Well, no. I'm not 100% sure if they've purchased it already, if they just have an option.
Oh, okay.
The neighbors said that they would like, to be protected, and they'd like someone to buy it. But that's...
Is that, does not show what Conservation Trust aware of?
Yes, they've spoken with Ken Hartlidge, the president of Neshoba Conservation Trust, and direct, sent them in that direction, because it does abut Neshoba Conservation Trust land.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
What's the vegetation there?
What's what?
Is it scruffy oak, or what is, what's the vegetation?
It's, I mean, it's, in fact, it's in the book, it shows pictures, I mean, there's some oak, there's some pine, you know, it's a forested area, there's, you know, deer, no, there's no rare species that have been reported. So there's no record of that.
Is it in the, what do we call it, the TCEC?
Not as far as I know, I was checking all of that for the project.
Do you have a sign in for the...
So across from the, across from...
Here, here's a map, if you wanna see.
There's the street with the high hedges, and the religious, what's called there, is that the right you're talking about?
Look, the...
You know what I'm talking about?
Chris has a map.
Yeah, look, there's a little, if you scrunch your eyes, you could sort of see where it is.
Scrunch.
Are you broadcasting something?
Okay, the heavy hit from last night.
Riding commission?
Did you see where it is? I mean, look, is it...
Was that...
Okay, that's Heald off the end.
Okay, this is Heald?
No, this is Heald, that's Park and Elms, this is Town Hall, you come down Heald.
Okay, down Heald.
And here's Heald, and then right across the cemetery is Plainfield. This is right where, Plainfield's right across the cemetery, so that religious thing's in here.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yes. But I can't figure out where this thing is in relation. Birch is off Plainfield.
Is this it?
If you start going down Plainfield, you're off on the right. And it's actually, if you're coming down Heald, some of the area will be behind those homes before you go right on Plainfield.
Yeah, they're coming on it from the back.
It's behind those houses.
The property we struggled with, because he didn't want the... Coming right behind there.
Yeah, good point. That's on...
That's the next one.
Yes, it is.
Did you want this back, Chris?
No, I just wanted to see.
Oh, our lady of Fatima.
You're showing where it was.
Is that upland at all, or is it...
This wet and this upland, it's a combination.
Yeah, that's, the sense you get, it's probably a little...
Yeah.
Well, that Sucker Brook, headwaters are just...
Below that, exactly.
East of that.
Yeah.
And where...
Because that's all...
Where's the protected land in relation?
I wanna get, is that right behind that? It's right behind. Yes.
Literally right behind.
A lot of those people...
Oh, could you put your sign in?
Absolutely.
And when I saw that, so I don't know if it's because... Do you see it on there? I mean, Chris, see the cemetery?
That's the one.
Yes, and see, it would continue down, Chris. It would hit kind of a loop.
I don't know the property. Yeah, there's like a loop around.
It's very close to Kimball, remember that property?
But it's crappy wood, it's very young.
Yeah.
It was Heald 50 years ago.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I know. Do you see it? Do you see it?
Yeah, I was looking for the Neshoba Conservation Trust parcel.
Okay.
And there it is.
And that's north of it. And it does abut it.
What is that problem?
Kind of a unique parcel.
I don't know.
Why they have that chunk of land?
Where'd that come from?
Yeah, I know.
You're looking from, or...
Yeah, oh, I said this guy, yeah.
Originally, we're...
I'll have to look up the history, I was, I should know that, you should know that, Rob, it's your job.
Anything happened about it?
Nope.
Is that, was that Sue Smith's property, Sue Smith parcel? I'll have to check it, if it's valid, then we don't, most of them we know, we have it down.
Yeah, the big ones are doing it. There weren't any trails on it, so it didn't make the trail.
There were no trails, no, there aren't.
Well, you can't even get to what it looks like.
Well, there, you can't...
The little green strip.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I know there's a log cabin house back there on Park.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah, it's probably behind the log cabin house. We looked at that one, we were looking at...
Oh, you did, oh, that's funny. Did you, when you drive down Heald, like I said, a lot of those homes that you see on Heald, across where the cemetery is, the open part of the cemetery, that's not, doesn't have headstones and where people buried, so across on there and you see it, a lot of those homes that are right there on Heald, it's actually their backyard.
Yeah,
No, because it was...
So.
This is a lifted, yeah.
That's the way they are working.
Yeah.
That's what they, so, that's the thing.
Is it finally 7:40?
I know, is it 7:40?
So.
Check that one out. Oh, not get to it.
It's 3 minutes.
The pepper cost, did everybody sign in? Who did sign off here?
There's two people still signing.
Two people are there.
Okay, do they want to come in?
We've got chairs.
The Pepper Conservation Commission will hold a public hearing under MGL Chapter 131, Section 40. The Wetlands Protection Act is required by the regulations 310, CMR 10, and the Pepper Wetlands Protection Bylaw. The hearing will be held in the Town Hall, 1 Main Street, Pepper, on Tuesday, November 1st, 2016, at 7:40 p.m. The commission will consider notice and intent filed by Catalano companies to construct a commercial structure, Dunkin' Donuts, parking lot, drive-through, and related infrastructure at 61 to 63 Main Street, within the 200-foot riverfront area and the 100-foot buffer zone. Okay, let's see, so it's, the source area is very floodplain DPW, it's electrated before May 6, 2002, so project must meet the 50-foot setback before it's not possible. Will you pay for the NOI? Legal notice?
Yes, I'll pay.
Do we have the green cards?
Proof of mailing.
Of some sort. You're just reviewing the extent to which the local bylaw applies.
Okay, thank you.
Sign that, here's the public notice.
Set?
Yes, go ahead.
Brandon Ducharme with Ducharme and Dillis, here tonight with Greg Roy from Ducharme and Dillis, engineer, and Matt Cantabasso, here on behalf of the Catalano company. We have filed a notice of intent for the construction of a Dunkin' Donuts coffee shop at 6163 Main Street. I'm just going to begin just kind of going over what the existing site is and what the resource areas are. This is Main Street here. This is the existing building at 6163 Main Street with the existing parking lot that wraps around the building like this. And there's an existing garage out here in the back. Varnum Brook is located here. This is a head wall. This is the police station, just gets their bearings. Varnum Brook is traveling in an easterly direction through here with a mean annual high water with a corresponding inner 100 riverfront and the outer 200-foot riparian area. There's also an associated boring vegetated wetland, which is shown in this blue line here, and a corresponding 100-foot buffer zone. This represents some of the existing landscaping, as well as you can see these red holes here are where we did existing, we did some test pits, which we'll talk about later on. This is the proposed site layout. And basically, we're looking at a 2,500 square foot Dunkin' Donuts building. This is going to be the proposed parking lot. The building is generally in the same location as what the existing building is. The existing building is a two-story building. This is a one-story building. We're looking at access off of Main Street here. We have an ingress and egress here for the parking lot. This is the drive-through kiosk here. This is the queuing line, which comes through. This is the drive-through window. And then we have an exit back onto Main Street. This also has an escape lane outside of the drive-through stacking that wraps around the building and exits out onto Main Street. So there's basically two ways you can get out of the site, through this side as well as going around the building. In red here, we have two subsurface infiltration basins for drainage. There is small retaining walls here in the back. This is a proposed guardrail that comes around. This is the dumpster location, and this represents the proposed landscaping for the site. This view here kind of shows the proposed development in relation to each of the resource areas. Again, this is Varna Brook, which is a perennial stream. This is the bordering vegetated wetland. This red line here represents what the existing limit of yard is, landscaping behind the building. And this is the existing garage, which is in the back, just to kind of give you a look at where the new development comes in line with what the existing development is. This dotted orange line is the 50-foot wetland offset. This is the 100-foot buffer zone. And then we've got, again, the blue dotted line is the inner riverfront area, as well as the outer riparian zone. So as we look at regulatory compliance, we basically, this is an existing site. It predates both the Wetland Protection Act as well as the local bylaw. It's also subject to the Rivers Act, which it predates that as well. Again, as we look at compliance with the 5,000 square feet of alteration, or 10% of the total riverfront area on site, we are beyond both of those. And essentially, this has been designed and laid out to meet the performance standards of a redevelopment project. And that's kind of what we're going to be talking about tonight. So as we look at the redevelopment provisions, we're doing a few things. Not only is it an existing previously developed site, we're also looking at it as a degraded site. And as you look, once you get beyond what the existing parking lot is and garage, we've got invasive species in here, as well as there's evidence when we did test pits for the wetland delineation, there's excess of 2 to 3 feet of fill in this area. All of that fill and degraded is prior to both, it appears to be Wetland Protection Act. I mean, it's not anything that has been recently done. So part of this project, as we look at meeting the compliance, obviously the new work is generally located within what the existing footprint of the previous development was. And as we look at impervious area on site, we have slightly more impervious area, just given the wraparound for the drive-through and the escape lane around the back. And basically, we're looking at a few credits on that. Number one is the existing site does not have any stormwater management. And this new proposed site is fully compliant with the stormwater management policy. And secondly, as part of this application, we filed to restore this degraded area in here. As you look at the wetland and this buffer zone here, there are some obviously mature hardwood species in there that are native and natural, but the understory is comprised of invasives. As I said, there's multiflora rose, and we've got some buckthorn in there. And part of this plan is looking at removing those invasive species, and we've included an invasive species removal plan, which just documents identification, proper eradication of such species, as well as monitoring over time to ensure that, you know, once they're removed, that they stay removed. We're looking at, and again, where it's most feasible, I guess, to remove some of the degraded fill, replace it with more natural topsoil. And we're looking at kind of trying to boost this area with additional native scrub shrub wetland species. And obviously we're looking to preserve the existing trees that are there, so essentially we've got to work around those, excavate what we can. In the buffer zone areas, we're looking at some red osier dogwood, high bush blueberry, sweet pepper bush, witch hazel. And in the wetland area, which is this area in orange, button bush, speckled alder, and swamp azalea. And basically, those are suitable species. You know, as we get in there, once we remove them, we can kind of assess the density and spacing of the plantings to basically reestablish this area and try to maintain a better vegetated corridor between the brook and the development than what exists now. Greg's here tonight. He's the engineer that did the drainage design. He can talk a little bit about that. We're also in receipt of comments from the commission, and we've gone through those, and we can look at those tonight if you want, but also just to take your questions.
If you had, if you wanted to talk, or can I know that this, we have Paul has been talking to the people at DEP.
Yep.
And they didn't start reviewing this project until the check cleared.
Okay.
And so that was yesterday, and they've been working on it for the past 2 days, but they don't have a written, it's not online, they don't have a written report.
Yeah, I looked, I didn't see anything.
And but Paul has been talking to them, so she can at least tell you where she is in her comments right now.
Okay.
Yeah, so the thing is, there's no number yet.
Yeah.
It takes them, like I said, once they get it in, they have to wait for the check to clear, then they start doing the review. There were some concerns with the hydrology, and there's a lot of comments. Judy Schmitz has a lot of comments she'll be adding about concerns with the hydrology and just the runoff and the area and what's draining towards the street. Is it actually being treated? There's some conflicting information in the actual charts and the diagrams, and she will go into more detail on that. And she was wondering, the area in the back that is fill, a lot of that, there's a lot of yard waste that's been dumped there. I mean, and she was saying, I mean, we should actually be requiring that that be cleaned up, the yard waste removed, as, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's probably going to go with the invasive species.
Yeah. Well,
but I think there was a question whether if it predated 95, and this is more recent. It was this organic stuff that's very recent.
Yeah, she was calling it, it's more organic, so it wouldn't be something, it's not people just dumping. There is a lot, it's dumping yard waste, which is organic matter, so does it really fall into degraded? So that's why we need kind of like a clear picture of any areas that you're, that will be pavement, buildings, and how that's being offset by what you're calculating for your degraded areas, because even the invasive species, you've got multiflora rose, you've got some buckthorn, but
Okay. Honeysuckle.
Yeah, so this thing, the things that are back there, even though you're doing like a bigger area, you can only, like if it's only 5% multiflora rose or 20% multiflora rose, that's the amount that you can actually take as a credit. So she wants to make sure that you're going to be clear on that when you're doing your calculations.
Sure. We kind of ran through, because I think we had the example of kind of what the precedence with the pharmacy that's in town. And we ran through those calculations based upon this plan. And when you factor in the addition of stormwater management, I think we're about three times in excess of what that number needs to be.
We need to see those calculations, of course.
Yeah.
I think that's a good reason to have a site visit to it. We've got it set up so we can see truly what is degraded. It needs to be restored. I think that'd be beneficial.
I think that'd be really helpful. And some of the trees, I don't know if you want to speak to those, Pat. Some of the wetland plants and things. Pat is a plant ecologist.
Yeah.
Retired from Natural Heritage.
Sure. Yeah.
So some of the plants, even like the blueberries and some of the Irish blueberries, the way they're located, they may not survive.
Those blueberries are fine. It's the button bush.
The button bush.
Button bush grows in standing water. It's not a floodplain species. It's inappropriate for the site. Those are pretty minor things.
Yeah.
I have a bigger question about the if you intend to remove, and it's not stated in what I saw, how you intend to remove the exotics, the invasives, and keep them out in perpetuity, which is a bit of a surprise and welcome, but I don't believe it, given the location. If those are well established, and if the roots are holding the soil down and collecting the toxins that have been running off in there, I think, and I don't know the answer, but I think it needs to be given serious consideration, is it better to leave the soil undisturbed, given that it has been a disturbed site for many years, and that's an undefined disturbed, there's no definition there. And when the, oh, there's, so soil disturbance is something I'm concerned about, the percentage of exotic cover. What do you intend to do about the trees that are exotics? There are Norway maples that are sizable in there. They're not as big as, they're not that big, but they're 8 inches diameter.
Yeah, I mean, if the only thing we could do would be remove them. I mean, we kind of planned on leaving the trees and getting some of the more aggressive species, like the multiflora.
Norway maple's pretty darn aggressive. But, as I say, I am, for somebody from Natural Heritage, with my background in natural communities and anti-exotic front, I think the site, given its location, needs to be considered of maybe not doing an aggressive removal of exotics and disturbing everything in the process. That's one thought. A lot of the things, comments I will come up with are thinking process things. They're not determinations or not ex cathedra thoughts on vegetation. They're thoughts on that site, and I do need to see, as do I've stood on the edge and looked down, I've not walked through. The percentages of species cover must have been done by somebody standing in a spot. That's not a very big area, and the species cover it's fairly minor detail, but it's not a good description of what's there from the description in the plan. I would like more of the species named, but that's really not a big deal. But it's not a big area to walk the whole business. Not stand in one spot, but walk the whole thing. And I think that's one of the things that I would do on a sidewalk. Now, I can't do it in the next 2 weeks unless it's tomorrow. But I can do it on my own afterwards or tomorrow.
Yeah, we can certainly do that. That's something we routinely do. The invasive species removal plan that's included in the notice of intent basically called to have everything cut and have the stems treated with herbicide.
No, I didn't see that. I didn't see the proper, that really did exist.
Yes, but given the fact that, you know, we are also talking about removing some of that fill material in there, and that's one thing it is worth looking at. I know at the planning board meeting last night, one of the members mentioned that maybe there's just some old coal ash or something in that area. That's what some of that looks like there. So if we want to remove some of that, you know, at that point, you're actually, I think it's more effective to actually grub out the multiflora and remove that soil and then bring in clean soil, but that's something we can certainly look at on site.
But from the invasive species considerations, taking out the plants isn't sufficient given the seed sources, especially given that there's buckthorn in there. And the multiflora rose, the seeds from both of those are going to pop back denser than what you take out. And if it's a 2 year or normal vegetation control, the new stuff has got to be established for 2 years. And that's nothing in the invasive species world. They'll sit and wait in the soil for 10 years and then pop up. But I think those are relatively minor aspects of the whole plan. I think that there are the impervious surfaces are more important, and the grading thoughts, which stem from the location of the building and the roadways, are more important and have to be dealt with first. And Bob, can I raise the next issue, which is the alternatives plans, or should I wait on that?
If you'd like to, if you want to.
I was just thinking. I don't find the alternatives analysis adequate. The plan, the one that said turn the building and move it back from the road a little bit, changed so many things in the plan away from the preferred plan that it was apples and oranges. That went back to 8 parking lots spots, which I applaud, but there was no discussion of the analysis. It was, we don't like this plan, go away. And that was similar with the use the existing house, it's not going to work, let's go away. That the discussion of using the existing building is a perfectly adequate one. I mean, not that the discussion wasn't adequate, it's a thought, it's adequate. But I don't think that what we have is the plan that's liked by the company, and two that won't work. And there are other alternatives. You could turn the building sideways and pull, and not set it back from the road as much, and have a broader swoop for the driveway in the back, and pull it away from the river more. It might not fit Dunkin' Donuts' master plan, but this is a small site with a river in it.
Right, I think that's just it. I mean, so when you look at alternatives, I mean, the entirety of the site is within the riverfront area, you know, and the project plan, you know, when you're keeping to the size and scope of the project, you know, there really is only so many different orientations, and to basically achieve the same project purpose, which, you know, what we really haven't talked about is the fact that, you know, there's a store down the road that we're looking to relocate here and help alleviate, you know, some of the issues that they have down there. And I think you were at the planning board meeting last night and we talked about these at length, and it particularly relates to getting vehicles off Main Street, having adequate parking to keep those vehicles from parking on Main Street, and basically allowing for better circulation. And really, when we look at this alternative, it's driven around obtaining those objectives.
But now the footprint of the building, how does that compare to the footprint of the existing? The existing Dunkin' Donuts versus the existing house.
Size? Do you mean like size or
footprint?
Size-wise,
it's larger.
Yeah.
This is larger.
Yeah.
Oh, because I was going to say there's a lot of wasted space in the existing one. Yeah. I kind of just looking at that, I remarked on just the amount of pavement and the size of the building, and that's
inefficient. Well, this is 30. They're going for 30 seats in this one, and the current one, I think I counted 14 chairs this morning when I went
into. And they're not. Like the place is packed out, so it seems I agree with the alternatives analysis and the lack of detail of other scaled down alternatives not being considered sufficiently.
I know parking was one consideration,
and there's a lot of impervious area there.
Yes,
and the dumpster.
Yeah, I mean,
is that the best place for the dumpster? Like right adjacent to the wetland area.
Will there be 18 wheelers coming in and everything, and where will they park?
Yeah.
They won't be coming into the site. You mean customers?
No, 18 wheeler, like to come in, the one that comes in every morning and takes the stuff
off
the truck.
Oh, deliveries.
Deliveries.
Yeah. Basically, yeah, they can get through. And this site has been laid out to accommodate turning movers to get them to the site.
Under the redevelopment section, yep. 58, kind of this one is. It says the proposed work should not be closer to the river than existing conditions. And if you put the two maps side by side, you can see the garage is, and you saw it on the plan, is about 44 feet from the river. And the existing pavement, though, is about 80 to 100.
Yeah, so that's kind of why I have this figure here. This red line here is the edge of the existing.
Right.
Wood line.
Well, but it's wood line, right, but not the existing pavement, impervious area.
Correct.
And so that's pretty much, you know, the basic concept is, well, you can be close as the garage is in that area, or as close as the pavement, which is 80 to 100. Or there's also, you can look at how much area is within, so you can average it. Maybe you'd be 60 feet away, something like that, roughly 65. But you've just, because the garage, seemingly, because the garage is 4 feet is it away from the river. You got everything, the pavement, and I think you got to kind of show us to justify that, how you
right.
can comply with that.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to put you on the spot now, because we're probably obviously going to need a site meeting, and we're going to have to continue this to get comments from BDP. So something to be thinking about, how you do comply with that.
Yes. So basically, I mean, we're looking to redevelop within the entirety of the previous development, and that's kind of what we're demonstrating with this.
I'm saying you're exceeding it in some parts.
With the impervious.
Right.
Correct.
And that's yeah. the issue is that yeah. impervious that doesn't exist now.
Yeah, and we have that calculation. Which
okay,
we
so if you,
yeah.
if you have
yeah.
it, fine. Yeah. Oh, but I think you just kind of could state how you can comply with that.
Sure. Yeah.
Very helpful.
Yeah.
I did have some issues with the hydrology, I mean, with the stormwater. I think those are the same ones you probably saw last night.
Yes.
Give them to the planning board, so you can deal with those.
Yeah, we could discuss a little bit, though, if you wouldn't mind.
If you'd like to.
I love talking, Brad, it just sounds like you do, too.
Well, as my calculation said, on the soils in your map, because you're showing group A and B.
Yeah.
And you're using for the routing calcs, but not for the recharge and infiltration. When the cul-de-sac chambers are all in the groups A, and so is that test hole, and that showed loamy sand, which is a group A soil.
Yeah.
And so I was concerned how you determine groundwater.
Yeah.
Because I thought the chambers were too low.
Yeah.
That was my opinion, that it was, there was only two tenths of an inch above where they're showing groundwater in that one ground, test hole.
Yeah.
And so that was, and of course, if it is a group A soil, you need to treat the first inch rather than the first half inch of runoff.
Yeah.
You also need 44% TSS pretreatment. And so that was things to think about.
Yeah, no, that was very good. And just to explain sort of where we've been with drainage, Brandon pointed out where we did the soil testing. Brandon was a soil evaluator on site, as I was, but Brandon is an actual soil evaluator. The soils there, when you look at the soils map, we're expecting a Class A sand. It was not a Class A sand.
But loamy sand is to as a raw number 2.41.
Let me just explain. So because there was a discrepancy there, and we're looking at it, it was tighter than we were expecting it to be.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a 2.41 inches per hour soil, in our opinion. We took a sieve analysis of that and actually had it analyzed, and it didn't make its way onto the soil logs, so I think it maybe just a discrepancy in that. But they actually classified it as a sandy loam based on the silt content there. So I wanted to have a discussion with that. I don't know if this is the most important thing, but best time to do that. But we're trying to just look at the site from a conservative standpoint. So I'm trying to be conservative in all analysis parameters. So when I took a look at the, we use the soil groups for the routing calculations. But when I designed the cul-de-sac chambers, knowing that the soil under the site was not a Class A 2.41 soil, I did not use that as an infiltration rate because I just didn't think it would improve. I don't think it doesn't infiltrate at that rate.
Okay, well, obviously.
So what I wanted to discuss with you is perhaps we, for the parameters that you mentioned with the 44% TSS and the 1 inch of water quality, I think that we'll just be providing you documentation that even though we're sort of being conservative on the exfiltration rate, we'll still provide those as if it was a 2.41 soil, if you'd like.
That'd be fine.
Yeah.
I can see you dug the test holes because you didn't want to dig in pavement.
Yeah, we wanted the pavement.
And so maybe you think it would be helpful then to do more test holes?
I mean, you can come into that. It's pretty consistent.
I mean, we discussed it last night. I mean, basically, we dug three test holes, and once you got into natural material, it was very consistent all three holes. The only difference is as you get towards the back of the site, you just encounter more fill. So, one of the things discussed last night was that at time of construction, we could certainly obviously do and evaluate another test hole, even go as far as have Neshoba witness the hole, because I know there was a comment pertaining to that as well.
I'd be very willing to do it, but...
Yeah.
But you don't think you can do it now? I'm just wondering if that would resolve it. If you do the test holes now and you can prove that you don't need to treat it as a Class A soil, maybe add the long one that saves you money.
Yeah, I mean, and just so you know, we did look at the routing calculations as if we're a Class B as well, and it actually gets more. You don't, when you change everything to a B, it sort of, it gets a little bit more liberal. You know what I'm saying? Like when you look at pre-existing runoffs versus post-developed runoffs. So it was more conservative, I think, to treat it as Class A on that end of things. So I just wanted you to know that the way we structured it was really intending to, we know we have a lot of resource areas on site. We're in the riverfront area. We have to be compliant with stormwater. We're not invoking Standard 7. We're not invoking a redevelopment provision or a maximum extent on stormwater management. We're trying to be fully compliant. So given that route, from a design standpoint, we tried to be, the steps we took in the drainage calculations were intended to be conservative, so I just think I need to provide some more documentation on that.
Okay.
And the soil testing, I guess we can ask the, we can discuss that with the team.
Yeah, it just comes down to the...
Whether we can get a motion to do it, yeah. So we can discuss that and see if that's a possibility. And your concern with the groundwater is a good one. We held the groundwater hole that was sort of closest to the groundwater elevation that was closest to the floodplain elevation. But the, you know, it shows a 60-inch groundwater throughout, so we're going to raise the system so we have the 2 feet of groundwater offset there. So we've already done a lot of that. We wanted to get through and make sure that there were no other comments. It sounds like DEP might have some comments too that we want to address. And we want to do that in collaboration with the comments we got from the planning board last night. We want to do that all sort of macroscopically once, so we don't have to redesign them. But we did appreciate your comments, and we're working through them. We anticipate fully addressing those with foreseeable problems with them. So. Okay. Groundwater mounting, you're absolutely correct. We need to do groundwater mounting. But we'll certainly talk about that.
Okay.
I think those are the main items today.
Yeah, no, that covered them all.
Additional testing was the last one you had on the list.
Right. Yeah.
And you'd like to witness those as well?
No.
Kayleen, or have Kayleen witness
I can do whatever is easier for everybody.
Okay.
You know, I don't know how available she is all the time, but it would be helpful, you know. We're not trying to hinder, we just want to get right, that's all, you know. That's all, no problem. Yeah, that was just.
So, I mean, we can discuss the testing.
Does anybody in the commission have any more questions or comments?
I had one, which is probably minor, but when I was walking the site today, I saw what our current violations between the landscape fill and some trash, which has not been there forever. There's still paper on the chair that was behind the garage, so this is very recent. It's not historic, so those are things that would have to be dealt with outside, I think, of the particular project. So you're proposing the project, and that's a little bit separate, but there are these other current things that before, if the land hasn't been conveyed to the new owner, that they shouldn't take it with that stuff on the property. It's just trash, but it's not old, it's current, and if we were running around pointing fingers at people, we'd be fine.
Just like hoses and
Paul, do you get the stuff from this workshop?
Well, piles of lawn clippings.
Yes.
They do, so just make sure.
Piles of lawn clippings.
Yeah, but there's a hose.
There's
a wheelbarrow. There's a wheelbarrow and a bunch of sandbags.
Yeah. It's anti-grit material for, it's this anti-snow, anti-ice grit or something like that, that are falling apart. They're not that old.
Chris,
I don't mean to harp on the dumpster, but is it really okay for the dumpster to be that close to where it is?
It's also closest to houses on the next lot.
The neighbor
across. And there's a fence between them.
Sorry.
I'm just wondering, just from a...
Did you have another spot that you were thinking?
Well, nobody likes to see a dumpster out there.
Well, further from the wetland.
But yeah, further, I mean, I was sort of thinking out. Yeah, I mean, and also just in terms of access for emptying it. So
yeah, these are all parking spots.
You have 27 parking spots.
27.
And
again, we're trying to alleviate some of the issues on the other site.
So
we kind of went back and forth. I mean, obviously going through the same thing, you know, with the dumpster. The only other option is somewhere over on this side, which again...
Which is further away from the resource area.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. We sort of looked at that from an operation standpoint. I think that's the best spot from an operation standpoint, like trying to make friends with the dumpster guy. course, you don't care about that.
That's on the curve, so you think that would be more difficult.
Yeah, I think that's gonna be the best, because he'll come in, pick it up, you know, back up slightly, then come right out, you know. And you won't be impacting traffic if vehicles that are parked in that location. But I understand your concern. We can certainly take a look.
I don't even know if it's split to the week, frankly. But
we can take a look at it.
But you could potentially be impacting the quality of the environment there, the wellness there.
Dumpsters are always one of those things where
They're necessary, but
well, they're necessary, but everybody hates where you put it.
Yeah.
Not everybody, but someone's gonna hate where you put it.
One more comment on this. On the basis plan, the numbering OP2 and OP3, but
yes.
The data sheets are OP1 and OP2.
Okay, yeah, no, it should be 1 and 2. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Pete, do you have any questions? Comments?
Yeah, so based on I like Chris's thought about building footprint. And it's just, you know, that maybe we could think this through a little bit more. You know, there's an increased impervious area based on the fact that we're in some, you know, riverine protection areas. There should be all effort, I think, to try to keep the imperviousness from expanding. And, you know, I'm just thinking generally aesthetic, even though that's something we don't typically deal with in the Conservation Commission, but you know, the Pepperell current site, it's kind of funky, you know. It's small, but it's got a cool feel to it. And you go to Townsend and the Dunkin' Donuts there, it's expansive. There's a huge area in the front. It barely ever gets used. I've met people there and nobody's there. There's like a table off to the side. So, you know, it's like, I don't know. I think Chris's point is kind of sinking in with me. It's worth kind of thinking about the footprint and make it a little smaller. Maybe there's a way to save some to decrease some of the imperviousness from this site.
Rob, anything with that?
No, I agree with what Chris said, and I'm not.
Does anybody in the audience have any questions, like to make any comments?
Well,
could you just identify who you got to serve?
Cliff Taylor, 12 River Road.
Okay.
So my property's on the other side. I'm on the other side of Kennedy Field. So I was interested in, when we were talking about the invasive species and how much of that brush and trees were going to be removed from there. To me, I mean, I've gone down and looked at it. Yeah, there is a little bit of trash that somebody's dumped in there that's over the years, and I've lived here for 50 years, so there's a lot more dumped in there that's been there for a long time. Because if we're going to have cars going over there at night, that's my only blockage of light coming down into my yard. If I sit on my deck, which is 6 feet off the ground, and even though I have a fence in the back, I'm looking right at that height of that area there. So the more trees they talk down, you were talking about the Norways and some of the invasive species of maybe leaving them there. Because if you go and look in that whole wetlands area, all the way from Ron's house at 8, down to behind Donlin's, over to my wetlands, it's all there. So if you tear off the buckwheat or whatever it is, the birds are just going to bring the seeds back down around.
If there's buckwheat in there, I'd say take it out, but everything else we do.
But what I'm saying is that I just want to know how much that's going to get cleared and reseeded and stuff so that those trees no longer are doing that function. If I go there during the summer and the lights are on at 61, I don't see anything. Now, this time of year, yeah, I'm starting to see, I can see all of his ball pack lights and the parking lot lights. But now I'm going to start seeing all of the cars turning and the lights shining down on our property all the time. So I would like the minimum amount that they could disturb that would make me happy if it does go through, so that we're not just clearing it all wholesale and they're throwing grass seed down and, you know, it clears all the low brush. The trees, the big hardwood trees, yeah, I understand we're going to keep all those, and there's some pretty big ones up there. But even some of you talked about the Norways, I believe those are all over in that area too, all the way down the river.
You do discuss, in their defense, if they take out the multi-floor rows, they're putting in other shrubs. They're not going to just put in grassy stuff.
Right, that was the kind of goal, is to restock that aggressively enough that it wouldn't come back.
Well, I want to make sure we're keeping the upper canopies too, because, you know, you got, there's a lot of hawks in there, and we got a lot of, there's also a lot of rabbits down in that area, and a lot of possum and squirrels and skunks. We have a fox out there now, living on the other side, so I just want to make sure we're not disturbing too much of that light coming down into Kennedy Field. I don't know if you've ever been down in Kennedy Field down there during some of the dark or dusk areas, but we get out and watch the, sometimes we'll watch the deer sit down back there, because right at the corner of the police station there is a big crab apple tree. They love to go get that crab apples during the fall and go around and play fools in the backyard.
So really, even in our opinion, it's at the discretion of the commission. You know, again, where we're working through the redevelopment provisions, you know, essentially working with the guidance that is an environmental improvement. That said, working through the calculation that we were talking about earlier, we don't necessarily need those credits in order to account for the additional impervious area. You know, the stormwater management alone, I believe, covers all that. I mean, really, so if we feel as though, you know, it's certainly a lot less work, especially in such close proximity to Farm Brook, you know, if we want to leave some of that, but, you know, I think it's probably best discussed when we're looking at it on site. But it's not something where we need to do that removal in order to overcome the additional impervious area.
The only, you probably know, it's 2-1. So basically, when you do create it, you get a 50% credit.
Yes.
Yep. But I think, I have read at some place, they'll say, for instance, if you had 5,000 square feet of pavement, and so you then, if you provide stormwater management, you get credit for another 50, so that gives you another 2,500.
Yep.
So I don't think you, just because you provide stormwater management, does it mean that that's considered mitigation?
Well, only on the existing, right?
Right.
And then
right.
That's mitigation, and you take half of that.
Right. So that gives you an additional 50%.
I think we're still going to be okay.
And we just
so just to give you the round numbers, there's roughly 12,000 square feet of existing impervious area on the site that has no stormwater water management.
Okay.
We're replacing that with 16,000 and some change. So 12 of that we get credit for because it's all going to have stormwater management. Right, so you take that in half, that's 6,000, right?
Exactly.
So now you do the numbers. So now you've got your existing degraded area, which is clearly at least the amount of the impervious area on the site, right? The existing impervious area, that's 12,000. You subtract off half the mitigation, you take a proposed impervious area, which is 16, and you subtract off half the, I'm going to have to give you the numbers because I'm confused.
Yes, yes, no, I don't understand, but it's impervious.
You can quickly document that you're over the number without needing the restoration.
Okay.
But we'll have to prove that to you, buddy.
That's right. And to this, you saw probably, because we've dealt with a lot of buildings right along here. We dealt with the medical building and the depot across the street, Donald Lenz, hardware store. And you guys should break it down, as you probably saw, within the 100 foot and then within the 200.
Okay.
That's how we, based on these workshops, DEP recommends.
Yep. Okay.
But that's basically, that's how they did it for putting these levels down.
Yes.
That's kind of, you just kind of mimic that. That's just kind of the information we need. When can we do a site visit? I think the sooner we do it, better for everybody.
I agree.
Yeah. When would be a good time for people?
I'm leaving Thursday for 2 weeks, so unless it's tomorrow, I will not be able to leave.
People do it tomorrow? Is it going to rain? Is it raining? Or?
No, tomorrow's
Thursday
night.
Nice.
Okay, I can do it tomorrow.
I think tomorrow's the only day I'm not available. I don't know. I work on the cake, yeah.
Just run behind us.
I'm happy to take it to the site. I'm the engineer, so I'm not as knowledgeable with some of the stuff.
Thursday?
Thursday's 50% chance of rain.
I plan to rain every day.
What would be the, you want to do it tomorrow? What time?
What do you mean?
It's up to you guys.
Yeah, you can take home the long grudge.
I'm the B, you know, the B squad.
Okay, what do you want to do?
So we're trying to get it done before you leave on Thursday?
I'm leaving at 8 o'clock on Thursday morning, so this.
So, I mean, even Friday, Thursday's going to rain?
Yeah.
It's Friday, good.
Friday, yeah.
Do you want, everything will be fresh people's mind, if you can. Want to do it tomorrow then? No? You saying no?
I can do it.
Okay.
Are you okay with that, Brian, or?
Yeah, I think, yeah. You probably could do tomorrow, what time tomorrow?
It'll be good.
I could be there at 7, but that's a little early, but.
No, what time?
I'm available.
Three, 4 o'clock in the afternoon?
I know, does that look later in the afternoon work for you? Or will you be gone?
It doesn't work at all for me, but.
Oh.
Well, you might get back by 4.
No, you got late.
Yeah. I can do, let me just make sure here, I'm not too much. Later I think would be better, I think I have a 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Tomorrow is the 2nd. Have a 9 o'clock, so anything say after 11 o'clock, I'm free. Or you could do early if you wanted.
About 11?
Well,
would you rather late in the
evening? I'd rather be around 3 or 4, but I can.
That's fine with me. Okay.
3 o'clock? Would that be good for you? No?
What about you, Chris?
No?
I'll be back at 4. I just have to pick up my son at 3:30.
Do you want to do 4 o'clock then?
4 o'clock?
4 o'clock. Is that doable?
That's fine with me.
You mean that's set tomorrow? Okay, and so I'm told your next planning board meeting is the
21st.
Okay, so we meet the 15th, but do you want to meet with them first? Because our next meeting then is first Tuesday in December.
Well, they kind of implied they want to get the planning board actually made the meeting continued based on your findings. So if we don't have the Conservation Commission's findings, it would be difficult for us to move forward with anything else. Sort of the chicken and the egg. We really need
guys input first. So, okay, so.
We've worked through a lot of the comments.
Okay.
Already.
Okay. He's the only one. She expects
okay.
it this week.
So then, do you want to then continue this to the 15th?
Time with us. That'd be great.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the next meeting.
On your side?
The 15th? You want
agreeing to it?
Yeah.
So you're just agreeing to the 15th?
Will you be here then? The 15th?
Me?
We need four of that original.
I'm here.
Will you be here on the 15th?
Yeah, I'm not leaving until after that.
I thought you were going to be.
You won't be.
Same time,
7:40? Probably earlier, probably about maybe 7:10. We'll do it the first one.
About
7:10, something like 5, 7:10, something like that.
The only reason I'm asking, we're going to make sure all four of you will be here, and at least 4. And Pete's not going to be here.
I'm on
board. Will you be back?
Or do we push off a little?
I'll make sure I'm back.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'll just, it's fine.
Okay, so what time is it? What, 7:10?
7:10?
On the 15th.
Oh, okay, good.
So I'll wait till 16:07.
So I would like to just chime in for a moment, if I may.
Of course, I'm sorry.
Ron St. Ange, 8 River Road.
Yes.
I am directly behind the police station, so I sit kind of kitty corner to your property. And Bottom Brook runs right through my backyard. And my concern is that we don't disturb the brook because it floods very easily. And my backyard can quite easily get completely flooded. So that is my concern. That's why I'm here tonight. That's why I was at the meeting last night. I really have no problem with the building, etc. It's the stream that may potentially impact me.
So that's
why these regulations are in effect, and that's why they're adhering to them.
And it's one thing we didn't mention. I don't think, unless I missed it, there is a 100-year floodplain, a bordering land subject to flooding, coincident with a 100-year floodplain, and we are not disturbing anything in that.
That's the two, what, 232 elevation?
232.
Yeah, 232.
2-1.
On the elevation.
But we're not disturbing in there, so we're definitely preserving flood characteristics.
Well, there, but what you do, will be doing is putting the water in, which probably is the same water that's already coming.
Well, we're actually, we're documenting that we're, our stormwater management on site is actually going to make sure that that peak runoff is at or below pre-existing for stormwater management, so we can.
But it's the same amount, I mean, it's not, you're not creating water or bringing it in from anywhere else. It's the same water that's already.
Yes, yep.
There.
Yeah, it's actually, the site does not take tributary areas that are off-site. So it's nice in that you don't have, we don't have off-site, a large tributary off-site area that comes through the site like you have in some projects, so.
So is all the stormwater going to be redirected to the infiltration galleries that are?
Yes.
That were shown, all of them?
You mean the front of the lot?
On the east side, right?
The front aprons do not, but we're reducing the amount of area that runs to the road. So in all cases, we're reducing the runoff that goes off-site, even to the road.
And is that eventually going to end up into Varner Road?
Yep.
Or?
Yep. Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how it gets there, but it'll go into the storm drain system.
I mean, it's not a direct culvert going into the.
It goes into the storm, existing storm drain in the street. But basically.
Just further, Kirk is going to go down the street.
But basically, we had to, you know, so there's two sort of things in play here from a drainage standpoint, and I apologize, I can talk about this all night, so cut me off. You've got the runoff that goes to the resource area, which we are concerned not only with quantity matching the pre-existing conditions so we don't increase flooding, but we're also really concerned about quality. So we've done the calculations to document such things as TSS removal and make sure we have the thing sized correctly to effectively treat the one-inch, first run-inch of water and those kind of things. We have an operation and maintenance plan that we'll be putting on pursuant to the stormwater management policy, those kind of things. Long-term pollution prevention plans, those kind of things. In the front of the site, we're not as concerned about the treatment because it's impervious area now that we're replacing with impervious area. We're just sort of repositioning it. But we are concerned with quantity because we cannot, we have to document that we're not going to overload or cause any kind of increased flooding problems in the storm drain in the street. So in both cases, we're accommodating that. So there's actually less runoff that will go to the street in the post-developed case than in the pre-developed case.
I do have a question about what's coming through the infiltration into the resource area. Now, is that, you've got an oil removal.
Deep zone catch basins, yep.
Is salt going to be dealt with somehow?
We have, well, I'll just explain to you what we have. We have, it's a pretty conventional, sorry, Matt. It's a pretty conventional system. We have all of the area from the pavement areas are going to the deep zone footed catch basin, so it's oil separation as well as sediment separation through the deep zone. And then it's going into the infiltration system, which is designed with what's called an isolator row. So when we discharge from the deep zone catch basins into the underground infiltration area, we're not going to directly recharge that to the surface. We're going to force it into one of the chamber rows that's completely wrapped and isolated and is not allowed to exfiltrate. And that further traps sediments, further traps anything that gets through. And then only at that point, when it overflows a weir that we have in this manhole, will it flood the rest of the basin and be allowed to exfiltrate into the system. Both of those systems are designed with that feature. So there's two levels of.
I don't think they'll be, that's a good point. None of that is going to address salt.
So if there's salt.
So salt's tricky because, I don't know what reg you would vote for that, you know?
Yeah, no, it's.
The DEP really hasn't.
Well, I don't know how you deal with it, but it does affect plants.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those, it's tricky. You design things in fully compliance with stormwater management, and you're right, it doesn't really address salt.
Is this a similar design to what's been constructed by hospital? At the Pepperell, whatever, the Southern Hampshire.
Health Center?
Southern Hampshire Medical?
Yeah.
They have infiltration basins.
Basin, I'm not...
I thought they had subsurface kind of...
They could, I mean, this is so typical now, it's pretty standard.
I was just wondering if they were running into any problems, has that been around enough that there's a lesson learned or any...
Well, the concept of leaching chambers, you know, these Coltech, they've been around 95, but I know they've had leaching chambers, but they were concrete in the 1930s.
Okay, so there's no lessons learned or benefit to just, have there been any problems?
No, I mean, the...
Well, this is...
Well, that's, I mean...
The isolator was one of the lessons learned, actually.
And additional TSS removal, pre-treatment if it gets group A soils, but that's the only thing that they added in '04, but the base that pretty much works.
So anyway, just...
Yeah, this is just, it's almost standard, you know, it's...
It's pretty typical for, especially when you're in decent soils, class A or B especially.
You don't have issues with fencing in an area, like a detention pond, you don't have mosquitoes, everything's hidden, it's underground.
Right, opening up a lot, a big canvas, you know, canopy of woods when you otherwise wouldn't have to.
Oh, I'm trying to make room for you.
That reminded me of your discussion last night on snow removal.
Yeah.
And I don't think there was any conclusion stated last night, but the question was, where are you going to store the snow during a storm? I think you said that you were going to remove all the snow off the site.
Yeah.
But what happens during the storm? Where does it get stowed? They're not going to remove it that fast.
Yeah.
So have you come to some conclusion about that?
Yeah, it'd be on the parking areas.
You'll have to take up some space.
And just, I mean, it's just in a snow...
Because it might be a couple of days it sits there before they get it away. It depends on the size of the storm.
I think they take care of it pretty quick. But, you know, just to point out, Brandon mentioned this, but we knew snow storage and snow removal was going to be an issue, so we didn't dare propose any back here. And we're actually, you know, there's a guardrail here, so that really is going to create a permanent, you know, it's going to be difficult to get the snow, you know.
So you dump it over with a bunker.
Well, you have to dump. You have to really work at it, I guess is what we're saying. But the existing site, we have the benefit here of the Catalano Companies operates the site right down the street, and they plan to do the same, a similar plan that they did, that they're currently using there for some removals. So, you know, they already have it in place, it's just a different spot.
Soil stockpile during work, where would that go?
We have addressed that. I think during the construction, you mean?
Yes.
I think we'd be looking at up in this area. It's probably the most logical spot for it, but away from resource areas, and we will address that under revised plans. We'll make sure that's in there. We're also considering revising the fence. I think there was some concern with wildlife movement.
We have a lot of things that run down that area, and they end up in the street, squished.
Okay.
So I know.
So promoting them to be able to go this way?
Yeah, just a little bit of movement.
Yeah,
just
so
a little bit of a space.
We are ending the fences, so we're trying not to go down farther than we have to.
Yeah,
the existing fence, and we're trying to approximate that. This, both of them were proposed to be a solid vinyl privacy fence. I think we'll be rethinking that on this side because I think the police would like to see some visibility there. So we may shorten it, and we could certainly look to give some space in there. Here we have a small retaining wall along this portion of the parking lot, but certainly where the fence has soil under it, we can put a gap there, we can adjust the detail. So we're working on all those. In fact, a lot of the things we've been working behind the scenes since we got your comments last Thursday to make sure we're addressing them. We just didn't have a revised plan set for you tonight because we didn't want to be premature and want to make sure we got everybody's comments.
I just had one comment, Cliff Taylor on River Road. That fence that you were talking about, the police station side,
that one, yep.
That you were talking about putting a solid vinyl, and you were going to end the fence, it wasn't going to come all the way down to, because right now the fence comes all the way down, crosses over the culvert.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're not going to go that far.
That is part of the police station.
Yeah.
Kennedy Field meets. And the reason I say I'm going to hope we're going to leave a fence there, because I would hate to see the kids come down there, try and go into Dunkin' Donuts and go through the back of the fence and try and walk up that resource area. I'm just thinking, you're gonna open yourself up to some kid falling down into the river, or they're gonna be down in the river playing.
Because that field does get quite busy at times.
Yeah.
And the other thing I did want to mention when we were talking about that is there is gonna be points when lacrosse is playing, and that parking lot is going to be full on a Sunday when they use that, or during the week or so. Right now, they try and all pile into the police station. The police have made it quite abundantly clear to them that they are not to park over into the police station side of it, and they will go and have them move them out of it. So they all come down that one hill on the, in between the 61, and they just pack them all in there, and they park in the parking lot that's there now, because obviously the business is closed usually when they're playing. But that's something you guys need to think about at some point.
Yeah, we were warned of that in the staff meeting, I think we had back in June, but that was a concern. So I think that, that's going to be an operational issue.
Okay, anything else? Okay, I guess we'll see you tomorrow at the site meeting at 4.
4 o'clock.
Thank you for showing up.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Yes, I'm sorry that I wrote on the front page.
Did you get a copy? You were supposed to have gotten a copy of this one. This was from years ago.
Yeah, I gave everybody a copy of it.
Do you have one for Chris to give her?
Yeah. Isn't yours in there? Oh, it's right there. Is that yours right there?
This is your copy, I believe. So I've got
yeah, you can have this one. I have extras. I don't know how I missed you. And you seem to have your rags.
Yeah, I do have
rags. And who's that? Is that
Emily.
Yeah. I know. So the next meeting we would have to have all four. We'd have to have at least four. On the 15th, exactly.
Well, I'll be here the 15th. I can't. The following week, I'll be gone.
Okay.
And I'll be here the 15th. I won't be here.
Are we all set?
Yes. Are we all set, Tony?
Let me know when you're going to close.
Okay, close.
Yes, close. All right.
I have to have dinner for God's
sake. Oh, dear.
I was usually bitten by a couple of ticks when I went to the doctor. They were saying that was the one I was bitten by.
We have them, yeah.